join us today. Today we celebrate the 24th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our celebrant for today's Mass will be our pastor, Father Richard Cannon. We have been asked to pray at this Mass for the conversion of sinners. A reading from the book of Sirach. Wrath and anger are hateful things, yet the sinner hugs them tight. The vengeful will suffer the Lord's vengeance, for he remembers their sins in detail. Forgive your neighbor's injustice, then when you pray, your own sins will be forgiven. Could anyone nourish anger against another and expect healing from the Lord? Could anyone refuse mercy to another like himself? Can he seek pardon for his own sins? If one who is but flesh cherishes wrath, who will forgive his sins? Remember your last days. Set enmity aside. Remember death and decay, and cease from sin. Think of the commandments. Hate not your neighbor. Remember the Most High's covenant and overlook faults. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, none of us lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live for the Lord, and if we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. But this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. The word of the Lord.
Two things are worth noting about this parable, the unmerciful servant. First, this parable is found only in the Gospel of St. Matthew. And then secondly, that's one of the most powerful and intimidating punchlines about any parable in the Gospel. Now, St. Peter, on the heels of last week's Gospel, remember St. Peter last week in the story of the power of binding and loosening. Now, after that, St. Peter asks our Lord, how often must we forgive someone who asks mercy? And St. Peter thinks he's generous, seven times. Our Lord says, no, not seven times, 77 times. Basically saying, there should be no limit to mercy, none. In fact, just says 77 times in the lecture. Many translations will have this, not, it's disputed, not 77 times, but 70 times 7 times. And the Septuagint says that, I believe, and that would come out to 490 years. 490. And the scripture scholars go back to the book of Daniel. That number 490 is used. But that's the number of years that in the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 25 and following, that the number of years it will take Israel to have no forgiveness of its sin. And it will know its ultimate forgiveness of sin. And the Messiah will be sent to Israel, will die for the sins of Israel. The prophecy in Daniel. But anyway, that number 490 is significant. Anyway, just underscores that our mercy towards others should be like Almighty God's, exorbitant, basically without end, without any limit. And then to underscore the point, and we say, yeah, okay, we get it, Lord, we get the story, we get your point. The Lord says, no, you don't. Hang on. Let me give you this parable. He wants to make things crystal clear. He gives a parable of the king, and he brings in some debtors, and one debtor owes, it says in scripture, in the lectionary, a huge amount. A strict translation is 10,000 talents, which doesn't mean anything to anyone. One talent is a gold piece that's worth a lot of money. It's worth 6,000 denarii. The day's wage at that time was what, one denarii. So one talent equals 6,000 denarii. And he owed a debt of 10,000 talents. I mean, it's basically, he'd never pay this off. Even if he won the lottery, he'd never pay it off. It's like $1 trillion, it's something phenomenal. And this king forgives his servant. You know, he goes and then he sees a servant that owes him money. And it says a lesser amount, it's in the lectionary. Strict translation, it's not a lesser amount, but 600 denarii. About a third of a year's worth of pay. A third of a year's pay. A significant amount, but doable. Now how does this unmerciful servant treat this guy? He throttles him. And why has him thrown in jail? Just to note, in those days, basically, if you went to jail, you just went to jail because it was a debtor's duty. You owed people, you owed somebody some money. You'd be thrown in jail, and the relatives or someone would try to come up with the money in order to get you back, get you out of jail. If you committed a capital offense, you didn't go to jail, you were killed. So if anyone owes like a big amount on your credit card or something like that, I know that's bad. But it could be worse. If you lived in the first century, you might be looking at some jail time. But anyway, so this wicked servant has this guy thrown in, and the king here finds out about this, and he calls the servant back in. He says, "You wicked servant, what did you do? I forgave you your entire debt, and you have this guy who also just, you know, 600 denarii. Have him thrown in jail." So he has him, he says, he has him, and he's going to throw him in jail for the rest of his life. And not only that, but torturous. I mean, he's never going to pay this debt back. And then the punchline. So all my heavenly Father do to you, unless each of you forgives your brother from your heart. What a most striking. And it's almost terrifying. Basically saying that if we cannot forgive someone who comes to us sincerely repentant, I mean, we have no chance of salvation. I mean, that's how strong that line is. In fact, that's why our Lord added that parable. And he wants to really make it clear. In fact, every single time we pray the Our Father, that point is brought back again. And the Our Father, we say, also comes from St. Matthew's Gospel. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's a very powerful petition, the Our Father. It's conditional. But the importance of showing mercy. Well, there's a story. It's an Irish story. It has to do with Mrs. Murphy. And she buries a husband back in those days. And Mrs. Murphy buried her husband. He didn't have to go to a funeral home for the wake. The wake took place in someone's home. And after the wake, there was a good number of people that came to the wake. And then the funeral, Mrs. Murphy's neighbor, Bridie, comes to and said, "Well, you know, there's a good number of people that came to your husband's wake." Mrs. Murphy just looked at her and said, "Yes, I can't tell you all the names of those that came, but I can tell you all the names of those that didn't." Mrs. Murphy, in the gospel, went two different directions totally. You know, as a seminarian, actually, I worked in the tribunal, minor details to it, small things. Now, one of the main priests in the tribunal, his name is Father Ponifer, a wonderful priest. He turned his anger. You know, sometimes we really turn an anger very badly, be very, very painful. And the doctor said, "You know, geez, it would have been better if this thing broke." But he had went up with the cast. And I saw him, and I heard the story. When I saw him, "Geez, sorry, Father, for your difficulties and all that pain you must be going through." And he was walking, and he stopped, and he turned, and he looked at me. He said, "Richard, it's only physical pain, meaning within. It doesn't come close to emotional pain. We know someone close to us who hurts us, a broken relationships." You know, in this gospel, we don't want to trivialize real hurts that we experience. They're there, and some of these hurts will be with us for the rest of our lives, certainly in our feelings. But nonetheless, if someone comes to us and sincerely repenting, we have to forgive them, right from the heart. For the mercy of Almighty God that is extended to us is meant to flow to others. Divine mercy is meant to be shared. The words of the Bishop George Haddock: forgiveness must be real, not pretending. From the heart, not in word, in the parents' home. Sacrificing all desire for revenge, all anger, all hatred, and resentment at the shrine of charity.
Church, especially for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and our Cardinal Archbishop, Sean Patrick O'Malley, and all our bishops, may they be worthy successors of of the holy apostles, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear
our prayer. For our country, especially those who serve in the armed forces, and for their families and loved ones, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That on this National Catechetical Sunday, God may bless all those engaged in the work of education in the faith. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our
prayer. For all those who suffer from hunger, sickness, or loneliness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our beloved ones who have gone before us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal Father, please hear these prayers and be humbly placed before you. We offer them through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Life to all things, make them whole. Have to cease the gathering people to yourself, the rising of the sun will say, pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you with the same spirit, strictly make holy these gifts to your body, consecration, and for us, the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, whose command we celebrate in these mysteries. On the night of his betrayal, he himself took bread, giving you thanks, he said to us, and he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples. Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body to be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Said the blessing, give the chalice to his disciples. Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. Be poured out for you and for many, the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory. Graciously, we praise this family and will summon before you a compassionate and merciful Father. Gather yourself and all your children scattered throughout the world. Wide apart, brothers and sisters, to all who please you with their passing for this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom, and we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, whom we bestow on the world, all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever. graciously grant her peace and unity, according to the order, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer to the sign. expectant of the Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies, of its effects, and our own desires, may always prevail within us, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple of notes. One, this Mass intention is for the conversion of sinners, and that's a special evening of prayer for conversion of sinners every Thursday night, the Lord's Chapel from 6:30 to 7:30. And also a week from Monday, from 7 to 8 in the parish hall, a special evening for confessions. That's a week from Monday, 7 to 8 o'clock. And also, some of the events that are supposed to take place in the spring, First Communions and Confirmations, beginning to take place in September. So if you could please keep our young people and our young families in your prayers, we'd certainly appreciate it. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And go forth, the Mass is in. Saint Matthew, God bless you.